Good morning. This is the time and place for the zoning administrator's hearing for December 9, 2009. My name is Edith Fuentes, and I will be conducting the hearing as hearing officer. We have three cases today, and relevant exhibits are posted on the panels located directly behind me. Let me just quickly go through our hearing procedure. Under the provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code, a variance shall be granted if four required findings are present. One, that the strict application of the ordinance would result in practical difficulties or unnecessary hardship inconsistent with the general purposes and intent of the ordinance. Two, that there are exceptional circumstances or conditions applicable to the property involved or to the intended use or development of the property that do not apply generally to other property in the same zone or neighborhood. Three, that the granting of the variance will not be materially detrimental to the public welfare or injurious to the property or improvements in such zone or neighborhood in which the property is located. And four, that the granting of the variance will not be contrary to the objectives of the ordinance. Also, under the provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code, a conditional use permit shall be granted if four required findings are present. One, that the proposed use will be consistent with the elements and objectives of the general plan. Two, that the use and its associated structures and facilities will not be detrimental to the public health or safety, the general welfare, or the environment. Three, that the use and facilities will not adversely affect or conflict with adjacent uses or impede the normal development of surrounding property. And four, that adequate public and private facilities will be provided for the use. For applications involving the sale, serving, or consumption of alcoholic beverages, there are also five additional criteria that shall be considered in making the findings. If the evidence presented in the application and at the hearing meets the criteria just described, then the zoning administrator can either approve or impose conditions for approval on the case in question. If the findings of fact are not evident, then the request will be denied. Notification of this hearing was accomplished by the use of public notices, which were mailed to property owners located within 500 feet of the subject property, physically posted on the site in question, and placed in the local newspaper. The hearing will proceed as follows. I will read a description of the application or the request, and then read reports received from other city departments and other letters or communications from interested parties. The applicant will be asked to come forward, stating both name and address, and will be asked to present the case within a 15-minute time limit. Others in support of or in opposition to the application and any interested parties will be asked to come forward to speak, again, clearly stating both name and address within a 3-minute time limit. Lastly, the applicant will be given the opportunity to make closing comments, if desired, in response to testimonies given by preceding speakers within a 5-minute time limit. The hearing will be closed and the case taken under submission. There are times also when a hearing or a case is a very straightforward, clear case, and the hearing officer or the zoning administrator may be able to issue the decision right at the public hearing. After the hearing, the decision will be prepared in writing and will be in the form of a letter sent to the applicant and to all persons who responded to the public notice either by speaking at this hearing or by submitting written responses and have provided their mailing address. I would like to emphasize that the date of the decision will be the date appearing on the letter. Under the appeal provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code, The decision may be appealed to the Planning Commission within 15 days of the date of the decision. Anyone wishing to appeal may obtain forms and brochures on the procedures from our Building and Safety Section, Permit Services Center, located on the same floor of this building. If you wish to speak, please write your name and address on one of these speaker forms, which have been provided by the front door, and submit it to our assistant. I would like to also inform everyone that the official proceedings of the zoning administrator's hearing are recorded on tape as part of public record. Okay, we have, before I move on to the first case, we have a couple of announcements regarding the other cases. So we'll start with case number variance 2009-037. Location is 440 West Los Feliz Boulevard. Applicant is Dana Garvey, and the property owner is Sandelson Living Trust. This is for a variance to permit rooftop mechanical equipment. So, Gabe?
Yes, good morning, Ms. Fuentes. Case number PVR-2009-037. Will be continued to a date uncertain due to the applicant's failure to post the public notice site or public notice sign on site.
Okay, so did not meet the required posting or public notice?
That's correct. In addition, the applicant will modify the plans add an additional request to the application.
So if we don't have a date certain, maybe I'll just take it off calendar. And are we going to re-notice?
That's correct. We will re-notice at time when the applicant does submit the revised plans.
Okay. So we'll do that.
Thank you.
So case number variance 2009-037. Location is 440 West Los Feliz Boulevard. Will be taken off calendar and re-noticed. Okay. Next case is 811 East Colorado Street. This is a conditional use permit, parking reduction and parking use permit. Applicant is Jeffrey Seymour, and property owner is Avetis Keshishan. And this is a conditional use permit to allow on-site sale, service, and consumption of alcoholic beverages, parking reduction permit, and parking use permit. So, case planner Dennis Joe?
Yes, good morning, Zoning Administrator. Due to mailing errors for the noticing, just for the mailings, staff is requesting to continue this to the next Zoning Administrator meeting on December 16th. The 16th, correct?
16th. And that's all the time you need?
That's correct.
Okay. Okay, then is there anybody here on this case? No. Okay. Okay, so then case number PCUP 2009-003, PPR 2009-001, and PUP 2009-004, location is 811 East Colorado Street, will be continued without further notice to our December 16th Zoning Administrator hearing. Okay, down to the last case. That was fast. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you.
Our last case is variance 2009-025. This case was continued from the November 4th and 25th public hearing. Location is 239 Jesse Avenue. Applicant and owner is Richard Will Dawson. Case planner is Rather Duong. This is an application for standards variance to legalize an unpermitted floor area addition without complying in the following areas: minimum interior setback, exceeding the maximum allowed lot coverage, and providing one additional covered and enclosed parking space, located at 239 Jesse Avenue in the R1 to H single-family residential zone, floor area ratio District 2, and Horse Overlay Zone. Describe as Lot 8, Block 3, Track Number 10116. And let me just quickly go through some of the comments. Oh, this case was continued by Laura Stadler. Yeah. Is she going to hear this case or?
I don't know. Did somebody put her?
Did she open the case and then continue?
No. Announcement was made that it will be continued to this date.
Ms. Stadler made an announcement based on the applicant's request or applicant representative request to continue the case from the November 25th hearing, but.
Can you just quickly ask her, because somebody put her...
No, nobody has said anything to me.
If she didn't take any action, then I can hear it. But if she did, she's going to have to rehear it. Did she read any comments?
No.
Anything? No? Nothing? No. Nothing happened? Let's take a minute or 2 minute break. Okay. Well, she's looking for. Let me look at the file also. Are you going to speak? Anybody else? Okay, we're back, and this is variance 2009025. Location is 239 Jesse Avenue. And just quickly going through the comments from fire prevention. Let me go through some of the emails. I we have so many copies. So. Okay, we have some letters from neighbors. Neighbor from 225 Jesse Avenue. Um, Mary Frances Fennedy, basically in support of the application. And I have signed petition 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 12, 13, 14 with 16 signatures. Again, in support of the application, these are neighbors from Jesse Avenue. From fire prevention, some of their major concerns are rescue windows from converted bedroom, fire department access around the property, and occupancy separation between existing garage and converted bedroom. So you're going to have, I'll just advise you to meet with them and discuss some of these items. Neighborhood services. This request is the result of a code enforcement case dating back to 2005. And 5 violations, including and if approved, they would request that the existing violations be corrected. Be corrected and conditioned upon the immediate correction of all remaining code violations prior to the variance approval. Okay. Electrical engineering, they have standard requirements regarding horizontal and vertical clearances from all overhead power lines and a 5-foot notch of undisturbed soil around the utility poles if they have one at the rear of the property, and existing electric utility easement at the rear of the property line shall be maintained by Water and Power. Okay, let's hear from the case planner, Mr. Duong.
Thank you, Ms. Fuentes. Before I start, I just want to like to ask you a couple questions just so that I'm clear on this as to what is the appropriate procedure. The applicant representative requested for, as you stated, for two continuances, one on the 4th and one, the second one on November 25th. Particularly the one on November 5th, that staff was told, based on the request for a continuance, that the applicant had recently discovered new information as to the addition in questions under this application, and that it was on some sort of microfilm. The department has requested for this information, but today we have not received it. My only concern is that we don't know the relevancy of this new information, since we have not seen it and reviewed it, and that may change our analysis of the project as well as recommendations. And so I'm just trying to see what guidance you would suggest to appropriately address this, since we have not seen this information.
I know. Okay, let me just ask some questions from the audience, because I noticed Miss Tracy Smith has been coming here and appearing, And I want to be fair to everyone and not waste anybody's time. Tracy, I'm assuming you're still in opposition of the application, or
actually,
are you okay?
I want to submit a letter.
Why don't you come over here? I just need to. I'm not opening up the public hearing yet. We're in just question and answer period.
I did have a concern initially because I own the property that abuts the back of their property where the building is near, and since we're in the horse zone, I have horses that are there. And horses like to chew on things, and they have in the past chewed on the corner of their structure. My concern was that if it's legalized, then I might have issues with damage because the horses can reach over the fence. Excuse me. The Wildersons and I have written up a document, and we had it notarized, that if I didn't have a problem with moving forward, that they would be responsible for all the damage that my horses or tenants could do to the building in the future.
Okay, so, well, let me tell you where I'm coming from on that. That's really an issue between two neighbors, and I cannot get involved with that.
I
cannot even guarantee you anything as far as your...
I trust them and their word, and
okay,
I know you
so,
can't hear, but I want this to
all,
be...
All I wanted to ask you now is... The case planner is saying there may be additional information that may change the staff analysis and recommendation of the case. So do you have any opposition in, are you basically recommending we continue it again until you get that information?
I'm not sure what is
because
the best
I can move forward and then you can just look at the documents or additional information. But if you think the information will be significant enough...
Well, Ms. Fuentes, that request was specifically brought forth by, not by the property owner, the Wildersons, but by Mr. Almec Shanazazian. So maybe he would be able to speak
then
on that.
Let's find out first what additional information is missing, and then I'll... But I'm telling you right now, as far as agreements between you and Mr. Wilson or the Wilsons, that's really going to be between the two of you.
I understand, but I would still like the documentation to be part of this file.
Oh, yeah, you can submit whatever you want to submit, and it'll be on file. But all I'm saying is we cannot enforce it.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Armick, just let us know what information.
Basically, what the research that I've done, I went to county assessor's office, and going through the county assessor's office, dated in 1966, obtained a document that indicated the area that they converted to a bedroom was recorded in the county assessor's office as a patio cover. So it was attached to the garage as a patio cover.
Having it recorded does not necessarily mean the city approved it or we issued the permit. So
but my goal was try to go into the record indicating that this project, the building, when they purchased it, the way that it was originally in 1983, this patio was constructed prior to that date. And I was trying to establish the fact that by doing this, the house and the garage was attached together. So I could submit those, and I have some other documents to justify this with the floor plans.
What are those documents specifically? Are they in relationship to what you found from the county assessor's office?
One is from the county assessor's office, and one from the bank that when they refinance, and one from the records of the... I had some documents that we went through the pest control, and they did in 1983, and the bank which went through in 19...
Without going any further, you know what, I think we could go ahead and hear the case and then let him present the information that he wanted to. I don't think it's going to change.
I agree with you because you stated that just because the county... registrar recorded the information, that doesn't mean it was approved and reviewed by the city.
Okay. The burden of proof is still on the applicant.
Yeah, I understand.
So I don't think it's going to change the items, interior setback, lot coverage, and additional covered and parking space. So why don't we do that, and then we'll just go with... Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we're going to proceed with the public hearing, and rather go ahead and give us your report.
Thank you, Ms. Fuentes. As you stated earlier, the project is located at 239 Jesse Avenue. It is zone R1, which is single-family flatland, floor area District 2, with a horse overlay zone. The applicant, through the variance application, is proposing to legalize some floor area additions that is located between the existing house and the garage. And this application also includes a covered patio, which is to the south of the floor area addition. And the specific request that the applicant is asking relief from is setback, interior setback, garage requirements, which is, as you know, any proposed addition or floor area addition to a single-family residence would require the applicant to meet the required two-car garage, as well as lot coverage. The proposed lot coverage is 43.9. The maximum allowed in this zone is 40%. So this project is 3.9% over the maximum allowed by code. The existing property was developed in 1936 with a single-family resident and a detached two-car garage. So there were originally two structures on this property. The lot is 5,094 square feet in area, and the lot shape, lot size, topography, and site planning of the property are consistent with the other lots in the neighborhood, and that is reflected, as you can see, on that zoning map. The lots are all rectangular, similar in size and orientation, so this is a completely flat area. From that perspective, based on the lot characteristic, this lot is not unique. It's like any other lots that exist in this neighborhood. The unpermitted work was identified by Neighborhood Services in 2005. At this time, staff is unsure when the addition was completed. Maybe the owner can speak to that as to when it was completed as a master bedroom and a bathroom. The once detached structures are now attached via this unpermitted work. Thus, the setback violation. Prior to the modification and addition, the subject property appears to conform to many of the zoning code, even the current zoning codes. The condition exists today with the addition in question actually changed the status of this property from conforming to something that is non-conforming, which is contrary to the overall intent of the zoning code. And also, through the variance application, the applicant is required to make the four required findings. Based on the review of the findings submitted to us through this application, staff was unable to make positive mm-hmm. recommendation or findings in support of the requested room addition and bathroom addition, as well as the covered patio. I would also like to add that the applicant is also proposing to remove the unpermitted bathroom and closet in the garage that's there right yes. now. And I've also put up some photos that show the condition of the garage and these rooms in question. But because findings cannot be made and that the lot is not unique, staff was unable to recommend a positive approval, so therefore the department recommends denial of this requested variance. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I just want to ask you, so basically you're saying all of the four required findings could not be met, or Did you have two or three?
Yes, staff was unable to.
Four?
Yes, okay. All four.
Good. Okay, thank you. To present the case, Mr. Armik Shanazarian.
Good morning. Armik Shanazarian with AMAC Group, 639 West Broadway, Glendale, California. As I indicated before, the project...
Mr. Yes. Can you project your voice a little bit so we all can hear? It doesn't have to be the microphone. Just they can pick you up, but I can't hear you that well.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
As indicated, we're requesting setback modification as far as maintaining the existing setback since the house is being attached to a single family, I mean to the garage area. I guess it's the lot coverage area that is exceeding that 3.9% over the allowable. But request or the project, my clients, they purchased the house in, I believe, in 1983. And as I indicated, I went through the records of this property. When they purchased it, obviously they did they went through the bank and they did all these requirements. And I want to submit this document, if I may get a copy back from you. This was dated on February 15, 1983. That's a document that they inspected the property for pest control. And this indicates, if I may submit...
Existing
condition of the...
Okay. Is this part annexed? Is this an annexed portion, or has it always been City of Glendale?
It's been City of Glendale since, because the original document, the original permit was dated in 1936 when they constructed, so. And the second document that I want to submit, again, this is dated in 1993 or 94, they had to refinance. Again, it shows the layout of the area.
Where did you get all this stuff? You did a lot of research.
And then, as I indicated, I went through County Assessor's Office, and this is done in 7/11/1966. There's a section over there that indicated that this was most probably in my research. Originally, it was constructed as a patio. I think this was constructed as a patio during that time because the way that it was constructed it's not something that the neighborhood services caught them doing, and that in 2005. I think this was done way before this, but there was a dispute between the two neighbors in one point of a time, and this is what backfired the case because the court inspector was researching the documents and found out about this. But anyway, as I indicated, my clients, they purchased the property in 83. So, and to answer the question for Mr. Huang, the area was constructed, or it was there in my research. By saying that, and having the area of the porch, let's assume if it was covered in that time, it was a porch, it was a porch in that area. So that brings, as far as the findings, if there's any hardships or anything, so that would create a place for my clients, or somebody to do an addition to this property. That would be an ideal location to do this addition. I know, if I may approach, I'll show you something.
I was going to ask you to walk me through the side.
If you take a look at the area of the question, it's this area, which I believe originally was constructed as a patio.
It was covered, but not enclosed.
Yeah, and if you see the line for the garage door has been maintained the same way it was originally constructed. So, assuming if this was not there, the garage would still be exactly the same as two-car garage. So I think in order to justify the two-car garage requirement, even though they constructed these bathrooms, if we eliminate this, still it's the same area that is being met, it was being built originally. So, but unfortunately, based on it, today's code, it doesn't meet, but based on those,
And that's the 200 square feet back in 1966.
Correct.
Okay.
Now, as far as the setback, the house setback, everything is far away. The only problem that we have at this point is just the existing garage being at that.
Zero.
Yeah. And then fire department comments as far as the having a separation, obviously there will be a fire rating over here installed in this area, so that would be the separation area between these. And as far as the electrical department is concerned, even though the garage is existing, the power line are over here, so they already have this issue. The building isn't built, and they don't. I don't think that they will create any issues. But again, if they have any requirements, we can meet those requirements very easily, because the height of this structure doesn't exceed, I believe, more than, let's say, 13 feet, so it's or 14 feet maximum at the highest point. At the edges, it's roughly about 10 feet. And I know the property is roughly about 5,000 square feet. There are some other lots that they've gone to variance, especially I know one that I do have a copy of it, which is they converted a garage, I mean, they converted a patio in 1975. I'll submit it to you. Majority of the lots in Glendale are roughly about 7,500 square feet. Unfortunately, this area, the lot in question is about 5,000. But the house is only about 1,266 square feet. And adding that 300 square feet will bring it up to roughly about 1,500. So it's not a major addition, but unfortunately, that's the only location that you could put this thing, do the addition. And that's the main thing as far as the findings is. Because of the characteristics of the existing house and the garage, the only area we could do addition is this section. I mean, there's no other way, even assuming that this didn't exist, the only area we could do addition is this section. That, again, would exceed the, adding the 300 square feet would still exceed the lot coverage area and things. Now, if the question is as far as the lot coverage, if the worst scenario, I mean, we can minimize this patio, open that up so at least we can maintain that.
I want to submit also these pictures of the property and the way that it is constructed. As you can see, the bricks and everything also, it's not something that has been done recently. It was done many years ago. You also have the support of all the neighbors, all the people on the block that is supporting this project. And it was submitted, I believe, last time in conjunction with the application. And if you have any questions or any...
In 2005, the violations were discovered.
Correct.
And numerous requests for extension were granted.
Correct.
And since 2005...
But the violations, if I may bring it up to you, the five violations that indicated. One was in 1960, there was a permit for the pool.
Mm-hmm.
That there was a pool built on the thing. And then they covered the pool. Now, since then, I submitted a record. Because to covering the pool in that time, the building department didn't require any permit.
So what I've done is I submitted to the neighborhood services a copy of the, again, assessor's office record that indicates that the pool has been covered. So they did in 1960, I believe, seven, if I may. Then there was a violation as far as the material used in the garage floor. Also submitted a document to the neighborhood services indicating that the material is fireproof, so the building department...
Well, they're going to recheck those anyway when
yes, they
you
will
go
recheck.
Through permits.
And the other two violation was this conversion and the having the bathroom in the garage area.
Okay. Shanas, we're going to need copies of these documents. So the 3.9% over the lot coverage, how
yes.
much how much square footage does that come up to? And I want it
about 200 square feet.
200. I know it looks like that's the very same area that used to be a covered patio, but
yes.
without walls, and I guess was finally enclosed. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, did Tracy leave or
yes.
okay? So, I was just going to recommend to her, if she really wants to enter into this agreement, you should really record it so that it becomes a document that's entered onto your property. And because you mentioned here, as far as future owners, they should be able to enforce the same requirement. Army, can you show me where in this property was Ms. Smith's concern about having damages or?
I can see it over her.
This is the existing
barn,
yeah, and then the horse was, I guess, this section of the garage. So it didn't have anything to do with this addition area because this is roughly about 2 feet away, but this is on the property line. So the garage, this section
well,
of the garage.
Well, if there's an existing garage there, the horse were just
yes, the
was just nipping
from
the
yes,
corner.
From the, but there's already a fence over here, existing fence wall, which is roughly about this high. But again, the horse reaches out, and this was the area in question, so that they had a dispute with this section.
Okay.
Okay. And the property owner has owned the property since 1983?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you. Is there anybody else here who would like to speak in support or in opposition to this application? You want to say something?
Sure.
Why don't you go and then fill out one of these
okay.
speaker. Give me your name and address for the record.
Brian Wilderson, 239 Jesse Avenue, Bendo,
mm-hmm.
California. I've lived at the residence with families for 11, 12 years. 1983, I was 11 years old when my parents bought the house. Everything was exactly as it was now. You know, the bedroom in question, the back garage area, there wasn't changes made. Parents have lived there for 40, 50 years. You know, and so it's just, it puts them in hardship with all these, financial hardship with all these changes. They are retired.
How was this brought into the attention of code enforcement, or how was the violation?
Yeah, absolutely, I'm not.
Oh, okay, sure. So.
I couldn't speak on that manner, so.
Yeah, go ahead. So you're done? Yeah.
The last thing I would say is with Tracy Smith's property in the back, there was a horse that was rubbing or chewing on a small corner of it. After talking with her, trying to be neighborly and work out a deal where we said, okay, look, if that's the worst, I'm a horse lover also, so I said, if that's the worst thing that happens here, we'd be happy to take responsibility, mm-hmm. the Wildeson family. So that's where that letter came from, and so that's why she changed from opposing to being in support of it.
Okay, so I'm assuming you have one horse?
We don't have any horses.
Oh, she...
She has them.
So how did the
I grew up in the area, so I grew up around
So who was
horses.
Chewing on the...
Her horses were.
Oh, okay.
Or actually her tenant's horses. She rents the house out, and so... That's how all this came up, okay. I believe, with the horse.
I'm trying to get into how this whole thing came into being.
Yeah, that one I'm not sure of. I just know about her concerns were for if her horse chews that I would hold her responsible to repair that little back thing. So we came up with the horses do it, I'm responsible for it. She said, okay, then I'm in support of the variance.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for letting me
speak. Okay. Go ahead and fill out one of these.
Mrs. Fuentes, yes. I'll show you a picture of it.
Do you have a picture of the horse? I want to see the horse.
No, this is the area.
Oh, okay. That's it?
That's it. So the dispute started between the tenant of her and...
Okay. Okay, closing comments?
I just want to wish that if it's possible to approve this project for the Mr. and Mrs. Wilkes and their retired people. They've been living there since 83, and as their son indicated, they haven't done any changes to the property. They purchased it the way it is. It's been there for this many years. It hasn't created any problems to anybody in the neighborhood. Every neighbor in that block, they associate with and they deal with is basically supporting this project. It hasn't created any anything to the public, any problems or anything. And as indicated, this is one of the, they kept the property very well maintained. Everything is done properly.
Okay, so, and I'm assuming you researched the city's permit record and didn't find anything, so you went to the county assessors?
Exactly.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Thanks.
Mr. Duong, closing comments?
Yes, thank you, Ms. Fuentes. It's unfortunate that the property owner purchased a property with what it sounds like an illegal covered patio. But however, the room addition and the bathroom addition to this room, as well as in the garage and the patio, that appears to be a later addition. Mm-hmm. And to staff, that is a self-imposed hardship because we are tied to making findings that would demonstrate that there's something unique about the property. From the perspective of the community planning department, there's no uniqueness to this property that would warrant an approval of this variant. While the lot size is not exceeding large, it's an average lot size, about 5,100 square feet, that's average. Given that lot size, other options and alternative exist to at least get some sort of an addition as well as a covered patio without having to go through all these requests for exceptions from the code. I mean, there are reasons why we have setback requirements for non-habitable living space as well as habitable space. There's life and safety issues, and there's reasons why we have parking requirements to get cars off the street, to make the street and the neighborhood more attractive, the characters of the neighborhoods maintained, and for the safety of the neighborhood when there are emergencies, for emergency vehicles and personnel to access the area. And the setback allows appropriate light and ventilation and separation between neighbors in case there are fires and any other hazards. So reasons that drawings or sketches or references to patios or the area in question exists with the county's record, again, does not make this work legal from the city's perspective. Staff has also looked at the building permit record on this property, and we did not find anything that substantiate any types of approval from the city. And again, the garage, when it was constructed, it would be considered a legal non-conforming garage. The interior measurements with the removal of the bathroom and the closet is 19 feet 1 inch by 17 feet 2 inches. So we would accept that as a two-car garage. However, in this case, it is not, because the door size is only 14 feet 6 inches. You couldn't get a two cars through that opening, and that's because of the location of the addition. So again, had this project been reviewed by the city as from the get-go, we would have identified these issues and advised the applicant and or owner appropriately as to the other options that exist out there.
Okay.
And that concludes my comment.
As far as the interior setback item is concerned, the fact that the detached garage was, the originally detached garage was attached to the main house because of the addition that was done in between, the interior setback, is that only for the garage, or is it because of the garage and the addition? Here, I'm looking at this. This addition here, mm-hmm. Was that part of the interior setback?
No.
Or are we talking about this side over here?
This side and this side is part of the interior setback.
Okay, so...
So once you have...
That's the one here.
Correct,
I was looking at... Okay, so this is the front, so that's interior, and that's...
Really also like the interior. Rear.
Okay, so the rear setback. And that is because of an existing condition. The garage is existing at that setback.
Well, the garage, even before the owner, from what I gathered today, even before the owner purchased the property in 1983, if we ignore the patio that exists at the time of purchase, the garage would meet code. A detached garage per the city of Glendale in the single-family zones is allowed to be located at the property line. So by virtue of purchasing a property with a patio that was attached to this garage, essentially the owner purchased a property with illegal construction.
The existing patio.
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that's what I was saying is, had the garage remained detached, they wouldn't have any question with the non-conforming.
Correct.
Okay. Because of the fact that the patio was covered and...
And then it also appeared, Ms. Fuentes, if I may add, that because of the addition and the patio, I could be wrong, but the garage door may have been changed to a smaller size.
It looks like. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then as far as the lot coverage, I just want to clarify, our notice said 43.9, so they're 3.9 above what's allowed by code.
Correct.
The drawings show a...
Yeah.
44 point...
We verified it, and there was some discrepancy. It's the 43.9.
So 43.9. That's what we're going for as far as the variance is concerned. Okay. And the garage, okay, we have the same dimension, so. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and take this case under submission, and we'll let you know. Thank you very much for coming, and I'm closing the public hearing at 10:25 in the morning. Thank you.